So we're talking about anatomy, mostly birds and mammals. We can talk a little bit about reptiles and amphibians, although there aren't any slides on here. The real reason is because we get so few of them in compared to all the mammals and birds. And of course, normally we would spend years talking about anatomy if you were in school, but we're going to do it in an hour. Oh, yeah, that would be helpful. So the truth is, for the most part, the anatomy between birds and mammals is pretty darn close to the same. There are some pretty significant differences, of course, like feathers and fur. But it all kind of works the same. But there are some important differences that we need to discuss, and what parts of their anatomy is important to us as rehabbers. So this is basically a quick summary list of the major differences. So, you know, we're all familiar with mammals, of course. Mammals have much more thick skin than birds do. If you pinch yourself, you can feel how thick it is. But even some of the other mammals that we get in, like raccoons and, some of the more tough carnivores, have really, really, really thick, dense skin. Mammals have fur, no surprise. We've got solid bones. And the truth is, our bones aren't really truly solid, but they're much more dense than a bird is. Mammals have a diaphragm, and if you don't know what a diaphragm is, that basically is, it's a muscle that is right about this level in humans, and it helps to create breathing. Birds breathe entirely differently, and we'll go over how that goes. Mammals urinate and defecate separately, just so in case we need some clarification on that. Birds, all birds except for one species, urinate and defecate at the same time. And if anybody can guess what that one bird species is, you get extra credit. Anybody? You're a quiet group. No? Sorry? No? Ostriches. Mouth and teeth. Obviously, birds have mouths as well. Birds don't really have teeth, but a lot of birds along their bill do have little like serrations that can help to kind of grab onto food, but they don't actually have teeth, of course. And mammals, both mammals and birds have a stomach, but some birds, a lot of birds have, they have two stomachs, and a lot of birds have a third chamber within their GI tract that helps a lot with the digestion. So we'll go over that as well. So in quick summary, mammals actually are pretty simplified. Birds have it a much more evolved or I don't want to say complicated, but more going on with their respiration and their digestion. So let's go through those right now. So talking about skin. Male skin is far more, I guess is the one thing where mammals have it more evolved. Within the skin of mammals, we can sweat. They've got hair shafts. They've got, for the hair, there's also the sebaceous glands, which help the hair to get lubricated and move out of the skin nice and easily. And there are muscles in there to help to control the hairs. Well, bird skin is far, far different. The first thing that I mentioned already is that bird skin is far, far, far more thin than a mammal, especially on young baby birds. Well, young baby birds, everything is especially true. And so with the skin, their skin is so thin that you can pick them up and blow the feathers out of the way and actually look right through their skin and see their organs. You can see the liver and the intestines and everything in there. So it's really like tissue paper thin. And the one disadvantage to that is it makes it much easier to tear it or to damage the skin. So if you're handling the bird a little bit too aggressively or if you're wearing rings, your ring could easily nick the skin and tear it a little bit. You have to try a little bit to make that happen. It's not just like you're wearing a ring, you're going to tear the skin. But just be aware of that. Also, in the skin, there are, of birds, there are, of course, feather shafts. And we'll talk more about feathers on the next slide. But basically, these feather shafts, especially on blood feathers, and a blood feather is a feather that's still in growth and development, The feather shaft goes all the way through the skin on, and will attach all the way to the bones, especially the long flight feathers. Also, if you have any questions, I'm totally open to just asking straight away. You don't have to be polite. I'm used to that. So, talking about feathers, obviously mammals don't have feathers, so we can forget about that. Bird feathers are an incredibly critical part of their life, far more than just being able to fly, but also it helps with keeping warm. For many birds, especially the adults, it helps them to either differentiate each other from mammals and females, or to basically look more attractive to the mammal, or to the males or females. So feathers are an absolute critical part of their lives. And a quick anatomy of feathers. So if you've got a nice pretty feather, obviously we're all familiar with the main little shaft that goes right up through it. Well, off of that, there are other shafts that come off of him, little barbs. And then off of this main shaft, depending on the feather, there are other shafts, and then off of that shaft there could be other shafts. And basically, at the end of all the shafts there are little like barbs or hooks. And then they literally like Velcro hook onto each other. So if this was a flight feather or a downy feather, it doesn't matter what kind of feather it is, they've got these little hooks. Depending on the type of feather, there may be more or less of them. And they all grab onto each other and literally just hold on and create that nice, you know, perfect feather that, you know, we would hope that all birds would have. Now, I mentioned that birds don't have the sebaceous glands, but what they do have is they have a little gland right here called the uropygial gland, and they'll rub against that gland to get an oily substance out of it, and then use that to basically rub across all their feathers to help keep them clean and help to keep them all the barbs connected and you know, working with each other. This gland here,
yeah.
Uropygial. Don't ask me to spell it because I'm being recorded. You know? But it's UROP something like that. Okay, so what is really important about feathers for us as far as we're concerned? Basically, if feathers get damaged, then the bird is in a whole lot of trouble. And feathers can get damaged by many different ways. Some more common ways that we see, especially, you know, from the public, if they found a young bird and they fed it before they brought it into us, very often they'll get, you know, food all over the bird's face. And with new volunteers it happens as well, which is fine because you're learning. But when you get food all over the bird's face and you know, cover up all the feathers can start to rot and actually get, you know, destroyed underneath that. So when we see that, we try to, you know, clean it off as quickly as we can. Another thing that happens is, especially with the birds in the hospital, in the wild, when a young bird defecates, he'll, you know, go to the edge of the nest and drop it off, and then mom or dad bird will take it and throw it over the edge or get rid of it. Well, we're not doing that very much. We're not going to, you know, picking up the poop and throwing it over the edge. So what happens is, basically over time, and this doesn't happen to everybody, but to some of them, they'll start to get a huge cake of poop on their butt to the point where they can't even go anymore, which is a bad problem because they need to be able to go. But also, when you get a huge, you know, wad of poop on your butt, your feathers start to rot. This is a fun class, by the way. So when your feathers rot, it is incredibly damaging because, for one, you can start to actually burn your skin. But all those feathers that rot will then have to regrow. So that's basically a waste of time and energy for that body to have to throw those feathers out and start all over again. Another thing that happens with smaller birds, but we see more commonly in larger birds, is they can get what are called a stress bar. And basically what the stress bar is when that young bird is stressed out, either by being caught by a cat or hit by a car or catching, you know, some disease, and that really stresses the body. At that point in the bird's life, when those feathers are being developed, they will develop incorrectly. And then a few weeks or a month later, when the feathers have grown even further, you can see like a timeline of when those the bad part of the feather was grown. And there's literally a line across all the feathers where they developed them incorrectly. It's called a stress bar. Now, stress bars can be okay. They can, you know, survive with them, but the problem is that makes that part of the feather really, really weak, and they can break really easy right there. And so if you've got a, you know, beautiful, nice, you know, set of flight feathers, and all of a sudden they all break at the same spot, well, now you can't fly. So the bigger issue to that is then we have to wait for those feathers either to grow all the way out and molt out and wait for the next feathers to grow in, or we've got to sedate the animal, the bird, and pull those feathers so that he can grow them in sooner. Basically, it'll take months or a year to get all those feathers to regrow back in correctly. So we try really hard to keep the feathers strong and healthy. And then, of course, the worst situation is during an oil spill when the bird is completely covered in oil. The feathers are basically completely destroyed, and you've got to be, you know, go through a very intensive cleaning process. And on seabirds especially, any spot on their body at all that has any kind of damaged feathers, if you go and put them back into the ocean or into some cold water, that cold water will whip through the feathers. And I should say also, on seabirds especially, their little white downy feathers, the feathers that keep them warm, are incredibly densely packed in, like so dense that you can't even see the skin at all. So anyway, if they're damaged, that cold water will get in all the way through the feathers untouched to the skin, and eventually will spread and give them hypothermia, and you know, bad things happen. So we got to make sure the feathers are in perfect, perfect, absolute perfect condition. Questions on feathers? Yes?
What did you say was the function of their own natural oil that they...
The oil from the Uropigeo gland, they use that to basically help to clean off junk from the feathers, but also to, it's kind of like, not shampoo, conditioner, thank you. So they, you know, how you use that conditioner to kind of make your hair flow a little bit nicer and look better.
Okay.
I don't know that they're too concerned about looking good, but they use that to help straighten out the feathers and all the barbules and make sure that everything's, you know, lining up correctly.
It's not a waterproofing thing at all. It's just a
little bit. The waterproofing comes from actually preening the feathers and making sure that they're lined up. Okay, so bones. This is pretty simple. Basically, mammals' bones are much more dense and much stronger than birds are. The truth is that both mammals and birds' bones are hollow, although in both the bones there is, you know, some density to it. On the, you know, so traditionally people think of bird bones as being, you know, completely hollow. Well, actually, in a bird bone, there's a webbing in there, so it helps it keep some integrity so that the bones don't just start, you know, mushing around. And the walls of a mammal's bone are much more thick. Birds' bones. Not all the bones, but many of the bones in a bird also play a very part and significant role in respiration and breathing. And so we'll explain that there in a little bit. But, you know, so how is this important to us? Well, mammals' bones obviously are being stronger, they can survive more injuries a little bit better. Bird bones, especially the young birds, it's a lot easier to break them. So if you're handling a young bird, you know, obviously you don't want to be squeezing down on him too hard for any reason. But if you are, then A, it's harder for him to breathe, but it's also a lot easier to squeeze the wrong way and, you know, and break a bone. Another thing that happens is, here, I'll use this so you can all see. So if you imagine that this is, you know, the side of the enclosure and I'm the bird inside my enclosure, if you're taking me out and you don't have good control of me, one thing that often birds will do is start, you know, just flapping their wings because they want to struggle. And what happens occasionally is a bird will start to struggle and smack down its wing on the edge of the enclosure and break the bone. So it's really, really easy to break a bird's bone, which basically means it's really important that we make sure we've got good control of the birds and aren't, know, pushing them in directions that they should be going. Okay, some respiration. So the fact is, birds and mammals, they're the chemistry, birds and mammals, we all breathe air in, gas exchange happens, and then we breathe the air out. And if that's all we had to talk about, then great. But it actually is a little bit more complicated than that. So I mentioned that mammals have a diaphragm. And in this picture, the diaphragm is this thing here. And what the diaphragm is it's a muscle that's, you know, right here. Separates everything from the top down from the bottom. And basically what it's doing is it's contracting and relaxing. And as it contracts and relaxes, the dead space up in this part of the body around the lungs, a vacuum is created. And with that vacuum, that causes, you know, our chest to open and close. Well, the chest pushing and going out is also helping to create the vacuum. But basically with that vacuum there, it sucks air in through our mouth, through the trachea, and then down into the lungs. And then when we relax, the cavity here gets smaller, we push the air out. So that's the physical mechanics of how air is coming in and out of our body. And when the air comes in, it just comes in through our mouth or nose, down the trachea, into the lungs, an exchange of the gas happens, and then we breathe out, and carbon dioxide goes out of the environment. Pretty straightforward. Birds, totally different. And I think is much, much more impressive and really exciting and cool. Okay, so before we get into the physics of, or the physical, how it works, there's a little bit more anatomy that we need to know about. So they have a trachea, just like mammals. They have lungs, but they also have air sacs. And to keep things simple, let's just say that all the birds have, well, for the sake of this picture, let's just say 6 air sacs. The truth is, some birds have much, much, much more than just 6, but we'll just say all birds have 6 for this class. And these air sacs are directly connected to the lungs. And then I mentioned also that some birds, their bones are involved in respiration. So we'll include that in this scenario. Okay, so the way that it works is when a bird breathes in, the air comes in the mouth, down the trachea, and into the lungs, just like the mammals. But then, so the air is in the lungs and some gas exchange happens, but also in that same inhale, the gas will pass through the lungs and directly into these air sacs. And that's like when you see the bird, you know, inflate. So now air is sitting outside the lungs and in the air sacs, and that's the inhale. And air can also, at this point, get into some of the bones. Now, on the exhale, that all of that air that was in the air sacs and in some of the bones goes back out of the air sacs and into the lungs, where gas exchange happens again, and then out through the trachea and out the mouth. So basically, birds' breathing is twice as efficient, because on every inhale, exhale, there's 2 gas exchanges happening, whereas on a mammal, it's just one. You breathe in, you breathe out, that's it. Does that make sense? Yeah. And you know, it's really, really cool because, you know, so if I'm a bird, there's a muscle group that goes from the back of their humerus, so basically the back of their wing, that wraps all the way around and attaches to their chest. And so in the way it works, if you can imagine my arm is that muscle, as I'm flapping my wing, I'm literally, this muscle is pulling up on my chest and creating that physical mechanics of, you know, creating this, the vacuum, the suction that pulls the breathing in. So literally flapping your wing and flying helps you to breathe faster or more efficiently. And so birds have to, their entire chest have to push that out to create that vacuum and that suction to happen. Now, if you were to see it, you know, if I had a whole little baby bird here, or any bird, you wouldn't, you know, necessarily see this great big, you know, movement happening. It sometimes is very subtle. But there's 2 points to that. One is that, again, if we're holding down on a little bird really tight, we're probably just being too aggressive to begin with. But if you're really holding a little bird, or any bird, hard, then they will have a really hard time being able to breathe because they can't get their chest to expand out. So we want to, you know, be gentle and hold them. The other reality is, and this is really kind of only true for turkeys as far as we're concerned, but really heavy-bodied birds, if they're laying on their back, have a very hard time pushing their chest up to be able to breathe. So in general, it's not the best idea to lie to birds on their back, but most of the birds we work with aren't too heavy-bodied, so they'll be fine. Are there any questions on this?
Maybe this is too detailed. What's the point? I don't quite understand why from the air sacs, what's the point of that? I mean, like when we exhale, we're sending out the bad air that's no longer needed. So why, when the birds go back into the lungs, what gases are exchanged after it's been used?
Are you a doctor or something?
No, I'm not.
Okay, so when we, even in mammals, when we breathe in all this air, so that the air around us is, you know, 21% oxygen, and when we breathe it in, not all of that 21% is actually being turned from not all the oxygen is being absorbed by the blood.
Only like a third, right?
Yeah, only a small portion of that oxygen is actually being absorbed up by our lungs. So it's the same with birds. When they breathe in, all of that oxygen that passes through the lungs is not being absorbed. So some of it, the part of it that's not being used, goes through into the air sacs. And then on the exhale, the oxygen that wasn't absorbed in the first pass can get absorbed on the exhale. Does that make sense? Yeah.
Is that why they're more susceptible to gases and poisons? And
yeah. Okay. So this is a really awesome, you know, thing that they've developed. It helps them to fly much farther. Well, they fly a lot better than mammals. But helps them to fly really long distances. It helps, you know, seabirds or diving birds to be able to hold their breath for a long time because they can hold in and then exhale out, right? So that's cool, but it also makes them much, much more susceptible to diseases, like respiratory diseases. One that, you know, we're constantly having to battle and be aware of is it's a fungus called Aspergillus. This fungus is everywhere. It's in this room right now. I 100% guarantee that we've all been exposed to it many times, but we can just normally and naturally get rid of it. Birds, especially immunocompromised birds that breathe it in, they'll breathe in the spores from the fungus, and then those spores will get into the air sacs and just attach, and then just start to bloom, start to grow. And the air sacs, there's very, very poor blood circulation around them, so the body cannot get natural defenses there to get rid of the fungus. And then, you know, likewise, when we anesthetize a bird, it's much more dangerous to anesthetize a bird than it is a mammal, because they, for one, the physics of their breathing is different, but also the way that they metabolize oxygen and carbon dioxide is far different than mammals. So the short answer is yes. It makes them more susceptible to other issues. Yes.
So you said when they breathe, they also push the air into the bones. So does the air they use in the sac and the bones also help them float?
Yeah, I mean, birds are lightweight in general. I actually don't know the answer to that, but it seems to make sense to me that if you're full of air, you're more buoyant, right?
So does the air push into the bones when they have resting?
Well, it comes into their bones as they're breathing. And this isn't true for all birds. A lot of birds it is. Well, let's go. Pelicans are the most adapted to breathing for situations like this. When a pelican breathes in, besides the air sacs, air goes into their humerus, this bone here, into their femur, into their keel bone, and, you know, all sorts of other bones all around here. So they can hold in all that air. And I suppose one of the reasons is that because they're bigger birds and they need more help to be more buoyant. So that certainly makes sense. One of the complications to that, though, is like if on a hawk, for example, if it's got a broken humerus, And, you know, it's under, in surgery, being anesthetized, and we're, you know, pinning the bone or whatever. The gas that keeps the bird asleep, well, when we finally, you know, gotten all the tissues pushed back and we're, you know, putting the bone back together, that gas is now leaking out. So the people working around the surgery have got to kind of work fast because now they're breathing in the gas. Yes?
Well, like in a pelican, if the air goes into its bones, how does the air get out of the bones?
The bones work just like air sacs, basically. So when they breathe out, the air will come back out.
It'll just get sucked out of the bones.
Yeah. Good. Beaks. So the next two slides, actually, beaks and teeth. There's one very, very clear message. It doesn't matter what kind of beak you have. It will hurt if it bites you. There are different beaks for different lifestyles, of course. So, you know, if you're a, what is this bird right here?
Chickadee.
Ah, who's that? There you go. Good job. So if you're a chickadee, you're, you know, very gentle. I don't know if there's any pictures of him in here. But you're a very gentle little, you know, songbird, and you eat insects. But even a chickadee, if he really wants to, you know, get aggressive with you and, you know, pinch down on you, it can pinch pretty hard. What about this one here? Yeah, woodpecker. All right. So it's not a joke. When a woodpecker pecks at you, it really hurts, actually. Now, the most, you know, dangerous one on here would be this guy here, heron. But we have gotten in one crane before. It's very, very unusual. Herons, or let's just make that more broad. Herons, egrets, cormorants, grebes, basically any kind of bird with a long bill or beak, and especially a long neck, is by far the most dangerous beak in the entire hospital. And these things are meant for killing. They are meant for, you know, stabbing down and grabbing fish or grabbing a rodent or whatever. And they will have no problem at all by reaching out and grabbing at your eyes. And if they get a hold of it, you can say goodbye. Yeah. So please, always, when you're ever working with one of these kinds of birds, make sure you're wearing goggles. And if you see somebody who's not, or glasses, you know, don't be like the cool person that says, oh, I don't have to do that. It's really not a joke. And I can tell you from firsthand experience, do y'all know what a cormorant is? Yeah, there's no pictures in here. Well, okay, so if you don't know what a cormorant is, basically it's a bird with a long neck and long bill, but it also has a hook on the end of it, and they can be quite aggressive. A few years ago, I was putting one back into its enclosure, and I was wearing my goggles, and I got him out of the box and put him down, and just as I put him down, he had a towel over his head to keep him more subdued, but he whipped his head real hard and threw the towel off, and reached around and he went right across my face. And if I wasn't wearing those goggles, he would have probably pulled one of my eyes right out. But fortunately I was, and he skipped across the goggles and, you know, helped the goggles do this. He got my nose and cut it right open. And I am, you know, Rachel says I've been here for 10 years, so I have some experience and I know how to manage them. By no means am I an expert or anything, but he's still able to get me. So it's totally not a joke. But these birds will really, really, really scare you up. And you've got to be very respectful of their abilities. And, you know, and even, you know, what you would think would be sweet and gentle mallards or something like that. But they've got this little hook thing there, and that's just enough to, you know, prick you and bite you pretty good. Goals are actually very mean. Oh, I'm not going to say mean. They're very defensive. And if there aren't any pictures of any hawks or, you know, raptors up here, but a hawk or an owl or eagle with that nice big sharp bill that's, you know, that is meant for tearing flesh, well, it can tear us as well. So protect yourself from them and make sure that you or whoever you're working with has complete control of the head before you start getting anywhere near it. Okay, this is the quickest slide on this whole presentation. It doesn't make any difference what kind of mammal you are or what kind of teeth you have. They will hurt. So, you know, it doesn't matter. Bear, moose, elk, deer, little, you know, mouse. It doesn't matter what it is. If it bites, it will get you really good. A mammal that you're most likely to be working with more commonly are squirrels. And an adult squirrel, if you give him a walnut, a nice, you know, pure walnut, will pop that thing right open. And so you can imagine that if you give him your finger, he will do the same thing. And, you know, we laugh about it, but it's really not a joke. And obviously, any of the carnivores, if somehow they're able to get a hold of you, they are really going to mess you up. So basically, don't ever work with a mammal unless you need to and you're in a situation where you're supposed to be there. But if you're ever working around any kind of mammal that has any kind of aggressive behaviors, please be wearing gloves. If you're working with a large carnivore, the chances are you'll be working with many other people, and it's very likely that carnivore actually will be, you know, sedated or anesthetized because it's having some procedure done on it or it's just getting an exam. Any of the large carnivores that we work on almost always are anesthetized for their exam. Cats, nice and gentle house cats, even the most aggressive house cats don't really compare to a baby bobcat. A baby bobcat doesn't take the slightest bit of crap. I just said that on film. So any kind of wild carnivore, don't go working with it unless it's very, very controlled. And, you know, it doesn't matter if you've got canines or molars or whatever. It doesn't matter the kind of tooth. Any questions on teeth? Did y'all get the message? You can get bit. Okay, digestion. So, mammal and bird digestion. This is one of the things where there are some details that we'll talk about, but basically it happens exactly the same. You eat, the food is if the food is broken up outside the body or just before it really gets swallowed, it goes down into the stomach where some physical and chemical digestion things happen. It goes into your intestines where it's absorbed, and then it comes out. Basically, that's it for both birds and mammals. But the way that happens is different. In mammals, when the first thing is, you know, if you get like if you're a mammal and you're about to eat a mouse, we got to break that mouse up into smaller pieces. So, you know, we do that in our mouth, right? When you eat a mouse, you chew it, you chew it in your mouth, and you break it up, and then you swallow the pieces. Well, birds, they don't break things up in their mouth. Where do they break food apart? Where? No. It's sort of a trick question.
Outside the body.
Aha! What did you say?
Before
they put it in their mouth, right? So they use their talons or their beak, and there they break the pieces up, and then they swallow them whole. Now, actually, some birds actually will take a mouse and swallow the entire mouse completely whole. But for birds that break things up, they do it outside their body. So now, once the food is swallowed, in a mammal, the food goes straight down the esophagus and into the stomach. In birds, this is where the area of the biggest difference is. Many birds have a part of the GI tract called the crop. And basically what the crop is, it's right here, basically in the throat area. And it's an area that serves as kind of like a storage tank, right? And it has a couple reasons for that. The first is if you're a hawk and you go and you catch a mouse and you've broken it up and you're swallowing it, you want to eat your food fast because the next hawk or a coyote or whatever is going to come by and steal it from you. So you want to make sure you eat it up real fast. So you can swallow all that food and basically you just hold it in your crop. And then in the future or shortly after, it'll start to pass through and get digested. The other reason is that some birds will actually keep food in there to regurgitate back to their young, to their chicks. for this class, we'll just say that no real digestion happens in the crop. Although the truth is that that's really not exactly true. There's a little bit of digestion, but we'll ignore that part. Not all birds have a crop, and not all crops are this great big huge pouchings. On like doves and pigeons, they have a great big huge crop. On some birds, the crop is hardly even noticeable. Okay, so now we said in mammals, food goes down into the stomach and gets digested. Well, in a mammal's stomach, now, of course, I need to diverge and say that this is a traditional mammal. This is not for ruminants or hoofed animals, basically. In the stomach, there's basically physical and chemical breakdown of food that has to happen. So if you've got your mouse and it's down in your stomach, it needs to still be physically broken down into smaller pieces so the stomach can, you know, basically knead it like dough and break it up. But also gets chemically destroyed, so it gets bathed in different acids to help to break it down further. Well, those same things happen in birds, they just happen in different parts. Basically, birds have two stomachs. The first stomach is this part here called the proventriculus, and that's where the chemical breakdown happens. And then the second part, which is more commonly known as the gizzard, it's also called the ventriculus, is where the mechanical breakdown of food happens. So basically the same thing as a mammal, but just in different parts. And then from there, both in mammals and birds, the food goes into the intestines, where it's bathed in all sorts of fun fluids and broken down to its absolute basic chemical components and absorbed into the body. Okay, so we're going to skip through all the intestine parts and go to the very end. In mammals, when the food has been absorbed and is all done, they defecate it out and it's out. Well, in birds, at the very end of the GI tract, there's one last organ called the cloaca. The cloaca in birds is basically the end point. You have a question? Are you scratching?
No.
That's okay. The cloaca in birds is basically like the end for three major parts of the body. It's the end for the GI tract, it's the end for the urinary tract, and it's also the end for the reproductive tract. So this one organ is kind of like this storage, if you will, for urine, feces, and eggs that are about to, you know, be birthed. So that's why when a bird either defecates or urinates or lays an egg, it all comes out all at once. The cloaca doesn't really control which one goes. Except, of course, with an ostrich who can do one or the other. So this kind of goes back to something that we talked about a little bit earlier, about how if the vent gets clogged or blocked, then none of this can come out, which makes it very uncomfortable and very potentially dangerous to a bird's life. So we want to make sure that it's always, you know, clear and there's not a, you know, big wad of poop sticking. There's all sorts of other details about digestion that we can talk about, but basically, that, you know, that's kind of it. Do you have any questions on that? Nothing. Okay.
Yes, ma'am. Egg formation.
Mm-hmm.
How long is the egg sitting there in the cloaca?
How long
does it take for it to form?
Well, you know? The eggs aren't actually formed in the cloaca.
Where are they formed?
You should have a reproductive slide. So there's no slide or illustration to show you this, but basically, so there's, you know, reproductive stuff that comes off here and goes over there. And obviously, this happens in the females. The eggs are formed in this huge, great big cluster of like 100 of little, tiny little eggs. And they're kind of all chained together, and eventually they form in a chain into like a very, 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 basically very, very soft and brittle eggs. So they're not even eggs like a chicken egg you would imagine. They're little like jello shots. And then as they get formed, they start moving down the reproductive tract. Where they start to actually get hard, you know, the nice, more hard shell. And even actually, the truth is, inside the body, the hard shell doesn't really happen until the very, very end. They stay very soft, and not to the point where they can get squished and moved around, but they stay soft so that they can easily pass through the reproductive canal. So by the time an egg makes its way to the cloaca, it's basically done and ready to be laid. I know there's no good picture to illustrate that. Any other questions? No?
Okay. Second portion of this class, so we're going to talk a little bit about wildlife management. I know Jean covered a little bit when she was discussing syringes very, very briefly. It's something to keep in mind that you may never touch a medication syringe and you may never give meds whatsoever. And it just depends on which shift you're on and what people are on your shift. I mean, maybe in 5 years, it might happen. Then you might be thrown into a shift that's really short. It's at one of the times where they're doing lots of meds, and you may get thrown into doing meds immediately. The rule of thumb for us is basically first years don't really do meds, but that's not really the case. A lot of times they get thrown into it. So. If you have a lot of experience with medications already, you've been a nurse or you've had a very sick animal for a while that was on 100 different meds, then you kind of have that experience. It is important to keep in mind that all drugs are poisons. There is none which is not a poison. The right dose differentiates a poison and remedy. So the drugs are dangerous if you use them improperly and incorrectly. You don't want to be giving, if you accidentally give an animal, because the charts got mixed up, antibiotics for 2 days. That can really screw the animal up, because what's going to happen is, you know, when you take antibiotics, you take them for 7, 10, 2 weeks, because you want to make sure you get rid of everything. But if you only get rid of the weak ones in the first 2 days, and you still got some strong ones left, you can have a reoccurrence of that infection, and it can be really bad. Now, if an animal doesn't need antibiotics to begin with, then, you know, hopefully it wouldn't affect it that way. But if there was something brewing or cooking or he was slightly fighting, you could really screw it up. So that's why it's really important that you take your antibiotics for the time taken. Because otherwise, you kill those weak ones, you let the strong ones stay, and then you have a worse infection. That's what's happened to staph infections in the hospital. I know you've heard of these really nasty staph infections. Those are from just not killing off bacteria all the way and completely, and the strongest ones coming back, and now they like barely don't even have the right type of antibiotics to treat them because they're so strong. So a couple things to keep in mind. Meds can be very dangerous, but they're also incredibly helpful drugs. A couple things to keep in mind also, as I was saying, you don't want to medicate the wrong animal. You want to give the drug to the right animal, the right drug, the right dose, right? We don't want to overdose or underdose anybody because that's not helping. The right time. Now, are these drugs supposed to be 1 day apart, 24 hours apart? Are they supposed to be 12 hours apart? Are you supposed to be 6 hours apart? Sometimes, like this time of year, when we're open from, people get here at 8, we leave at 6, that's not quite 12 hours. So we got to get those meds that are twice a day done as early as possible and as late as possible. But we still got to get out of here in time. So sometimes those drugs only get about 8 to 6 to 7 hours between each other. Not great, but that's what we are able to do. Also the right route. You don't want to give a oral drug injectably. That could be a really serious problem. I think that happened in a hospital not too long ago. Somebody gave what was supposed to be gavaged into the person. They did it through a syringe and they killed the person. I think that was like a year or two ago. So yeah, you want to make sure it goes in the right way. You don't want food through a IV catheter. You might clog your system a little bit. So what in the hospital particularly, and this is just more or less the medical field, but in the hospital, what do we treat? Infections, any sort of wounds, open wounds, some nasty stuff can happen. Cat caught animals. I mean, you see what happens to a cat caught wound and the animal 24 hours after a cat catch. it is really, really bad. And I just had a pretty amazing experience with that, where I was house sitting and their cat got a hold of their parrot, which is like never happened in the 12 years that they've been together. We didn't really, it looked just like a whack, which my cat's been to my parrots a million times, put the parrot in the cage. The next evening when I came home, the parrot hadn't touched any of its food, and it looked like it was on death's door. And when I took it to the vet, and finally, just a couple days ago, the last of the giant infection that happened from a small laceration right here was coming out and finally fell off. I mean, this infection was giant. That's in 24 hours, this bird would have been dead if I hadn't noticed that there was something seriously wrong, from a small cat scratch right here and one on the back of her head. That's it. So cat caught animals definitely need to be put on antibiotics immediately. Parasites, there's parasites out there. They come in with parasites. And what happens with parasites is that parasites are a very normal thing out there. You know, coccidia, many animals, especially all the corvids, have some small level of coccidia. But when they get into a immune compromised situation, such as hitting a window, falling out of a nest, getting a cat attacked by a predator, that's an immune compromised position. And then they come into the hospital where they're constantly seeing people that want to eat them all the time, right? And that's just terrifying. So then their immune system plummets, and those bacteria or coccidia or whatever parasite they have just go wee, and they blow up. So that's something that we sometimes will treat prophylactically. Like, we'll always treat the raccoon roundworm on all the raccoons that come in, so that there's not a whole bunch of raccoon roundworms out there. There's some birds like the robins that are notorious for always having tapeworms, so we always treat them for tapeworm. Squirrels, whether they have mange or not, they've probably been exposed to it, so we give them ivermectin so that they don't have mange here and they don't spread it to anybody else. So there's certain things that we will prophylactically treat too. Inflammation. If you were to run headlong into a car, you might have some swelling in a couple places, particularly the head. So same things happens with these guys. When they get hit by a car, they hit a window, there's some swelling going on, and it's really, really important to bring that swelling down, otherwise there can be some permanent brain damage. So a lot of these guys will give Medicam, seems to be the miracle drug nowadays, and it will help with the pain and it will help bring down the swelling. Pain. Pain is kind of a new thing that we've really been working hard towards treating. Animals don't tend to really express pain that much, so you can't really tell if they're in pain or if they're not in pain. Sometimes you can. I mean, you know, your dog like kind of hurts his paw, or he's got something stuck in it, and he starts limping, but that's just being a baby. But a lot of these animals really don't show that they have pain. But if it looks ouchy, you better believe it is. And they will go through a much better recovery if they have less pain. So we really highly dose them with pain, especially when they first come in. Even pretty big bruises we'll treat with pain meds. Anything, any sort of inflammation we'll treat with pain also. And we give it to them frequently and pretty high doses, because they will help them eat. Sometimes we've taken them off pain drugs and all of a sudden they stop eating because they're in pain. They don't want to eat, you know. So it's important to monitor their pain. And support. It's not really necessarily a condition that we use drugs to treat, but we can't do any of these without support. There has to be that supportive care, which is critical. It's the heat, it's the husbandry, it's the fluids, it's all that stuff that without these meds, you have to monitor when you give these meds and how you give them, because an animal that comes in totally in shock, you just got to get it stable before you start pumping anything into it. So that's something also that we have to keep in mind. And we are an emergency clinic for the most part. Things come into us in emergency situations, so we have to treat them that way. And supportive care is one of the most important things. So how are these drugs administered? How do we give them? We do have some topical drugs. Parasites, external parasites. Not uncommon to go home and find a flea in your bra. Just happens. I don't think I've ever gone home with a tick, but I have had feather flies crawling on me, which are the creepiest things ever, next to bot flies. Does anyone know what a bot fly is?
Yes.
They're gross. Usually if we find them at full stage, they're in rabbits, and they're like this big white giant larva that's under the skin with that little hole in the skin that it can breathe out of. And then you have to kind of slice open the skin and pop it out. And then you can stick it in alcohol, because usually alcohol is a really quick killer for a lot of the parasites, and it'll still be alive like 6 hours later.
Wow.
They're really gross. Luckily, people don't really get them here, but somehow the rabbits get them. So anyways, external parasites, the seven dust will use, if there's mites or fleas, we'll just do a little bit of seven dust. If there's something really nasty, they'll use the Ovitrol, which is this really horrid spray. I can walk into the treatment room and walk right back out if they've sprayed Ovitrol, because I will get lightheaded and dizzy and nauseous within like 5 seconds. I'm just sensitive to that kind of stuff, but Ovitrol is pretty nasty stuff.
Is that also for mites and fleas?
External parasites. Sometimes we'll spend time, if we have like a, you know, something that, like a baby fox or a fawn that comes in that's covered in ticks, we'll spend some time just picking all the ticks off of it. Also, tick paralysis can be a problem. All it takes is one tick with that nasty stuff in it, but taking them out is usually going to help them not lose so much blood in a traumatic situation. And DMSO cocktail. Many of you probably know what DMSO is. DMSO is kind of a fascinating substance. It is basically an agent that wicks stuff through the skin. So if you put it on your skin, it will wick everything on your skin and whatever's in the DMSO through your skin into your bloodstream. Kind of cool if you think about it, but can also be kind of nasty if you have some nasty stuff on your hand or on your skin and you put DMSO on it. You don't know what kind of stuff is then going into your body. So what we use DMSO for is if there's like a, you know, birds, Devin just went over the kind of the anatomy of birds, and there's some areas in birds that have just not a very good circulation just because of the way they're designed. Like their skin is really, really thin, and there's just not a lot of blood going to it because it is so thin. Like, you know, you could cut us and we'll just bleed. You can cut them and they won't bleed. And also just like the outer layers of their muscles, there's just not a lot of circulation. So oral meds going to that particular infection site might not be, you know, everything that it needs to be. So we'll put this DMSO cocktail on, which has an antibiotic in it, and we'll apply it directly to the site or around the site if it's a wound. So that will actually get antibiotics directly to the wound. And let's see, so that's topical. Then we have oral, PO, per os. And this is usually the way we give meds, in the mouth, not too hard. There's a bunch of different ways to do it. You wanna be careful with bird beaks because you don't wanna just necessarily sit there and pry them open because, you know, you can hurt a little tiny beak. I'm trying to give meds to a hummingbird. Anyone try that recently? No. So we'll give antibiotics, antiparasitics, and also nutritional supplements, such as Peptenic orally. Also our pain meds are usually orally. We do have some injectable pain meds, some injectable antibiotics, stuff like that. But most of what we do is oral. And we're not gonna be asking you, obviously, to do any IV or IM meds anytime soon. So the other way that we do some is subcutaneous, so that's just directly under the skin. Most of what we do under the skin are fluids. So an animal comes in really emaciated or dehydrated, especially like a baby squirrel that's been out of its nest for 2 days, you know, that's going to be something we're going to pump fluids into. You have to be careful about it because we don't want to also drown the body. You give a whole bunch of fluids to a bird that's all, or an animal that's already really compromised, and then you're just gonna flush them out. They're not gonna have a good chance that way. So we'll do a lot of fluids. Anti-inflammatories and antibiotics, like I said, are also given. Some pain drugs are also, like butorphanol, given an injection if we really need to. we do have some controlled substances upstairs that in emergencies we can use. If someone's in a seizure that's obviously not rabies, then we might give Valium or something like that. But that's with the vet's discretion. That's in charge of that. So also I am into the muscle and IV. We don't do very many IV meds. Most of them can be done into the muscle if we have to. But you know, they some of them will be done. So the most common antibiotics we use, you may or have heard of these before. Anyone heard of amoxicillin before? Yeah. So amoxicillin works best for mammals. Doesn't seem to work so good for birds because the birds have a much higher metabolism than mammals. So we would have to give amoxicillin like every 4 hours. That's a lot of handling for an animal that doesn't want to be handled. So endofloxacin. Endo is Baytril, basically. Many of you have heard of Baytril at some point or other. It's good for a lot of things, and it's good for certain bacteria and not good for certain bacteria. So when all else fails and our other cephalexin isn't working, then we'll add in Baytril. But Baytril is a lot of time for respiratory or bacteria that is not in a exposed to the air, basically. It's very, anaerobic? Mm-hmm. Anaerobic situations. Clindamycin, doxycycline. We'll use doxy if there's a tick paralysis. And they, once they're put on doxy, they're on it for like 45 days. So you got to be careful about when you put an animal on doxycycline. And I know they use doxycycline a lot for people. And I've heard that some of these antibiotics, when given to people, are horrid. They make you lose your appetite and you just feel nauseous and sick. So imagine how these animals feel. A lot of them, when they're put on long doses of antibiotics, doesn't really necessarily make them feel very good. Cephalexin is the most common one that we use. We use that for almost everything. It's a really broad-based antibiotic, and it's really cheap. So these little capsules of 500 mg will give us 5 milliliters of cephalexin. So considering most of our animals are getting somewhere between 0.01 and 0.05 cephalexin, that takes us a really long way. And a bottle of those is not very expensive. So it's a very good, inexpensive way to treat most of our animals. If it's really bad, we'll use Clavamox, which is kind of a mixture between cephalexin and amoxicillin. And it's a really, really good drug. So if we have something that's really serious that's not getting better, sometimes we'll throw in Clavamox, but it's much, much, much more expensive. And you have to make it up in an entire bottle, so we have to use the entire bottle. And the bottles are like $25 each. So it's much more expensive. So antiparasitics. I still, after all these years, can't pronounce half of these generic names. I don't know what they were thinking when they designed these. I think I can say fenbendazole. Yeah. Use that for nematodes and flukes. We see some really nasty stuff here. I can't really say that next one, unless somebody can. I think it's praziquantel?
Yeah.
Yeah? Okay, good. I can say carnitazole. I know that one. Trichomonosis, this is also known as Bartrex. That's the brand name, which we'll talk about a little bit in a second. This is very common. A lot of times we'll give some animals prophylactic for this, or we will test every single house finch that comes into the building for trich to make sure it doesn't have it, because once they do have it, it's kind of hard to get rid of. It really compromises their immune system and it's very easily spread. So that's kind of a nasty thing to get into a cage. Cool. Trazole.
Hi, Rachel.
There you go. Okay. Coccidia, another kind of nasty parasite. Ivermectin. Ivermectin's awesome. You can use it for almost anything. Any topical parasite, ivermectin's great. And pyrantel, like I said, all of our raccoons will be treated when they come in with pyrantel every 6 weeks or something like that to make sure that they don't have raccoon roundworms, which I'm sure you learned about raccoon roundworms in Susan's class. The little worms crawling up into your brain. sounds gross, and we probably, all of us, have roundworm cysts all up in our bodies all over the place from playing in the playgrounds when we were children. Yeah. Because there's raccoon poop out there everywhere, and if raccoon roundworm actually truly can live forever, then you can pretty much guess that it's out there everywhere. And I think we've gotten, one of the problems with a lot of the otters that have come into us in the past, they have like some sort of something going on neurologically. We think that they may actually have some form of raccoon realm worm, like the babies come in a little neuro, so you can't help it. There's species in the trap, you know, in the water, and what are you gonna do? But there's also, I'm sure they're immune compromised in other ways for that to happen. And I mean, really, truly, we only have one main antifungal, and it's itraconazole. And we use it for if anyone exhibits aspergillus. Now, if you ever aspirate an animal, which is basically getting fluid or food into their lungs, it has a really good chance of getting aspergillus. Aspergillus is out there. It's everywhere. And in birds, they're really, really vulnerable to aspergillus, especially in rehab situations. We try to keep the air as clean as possible. We don't do nearly a good enough job. And when they are put into a situation where it's kind of closed quarters and they do have aspergillus, it can really just infect. Out there in the world, there's a little bit more fresh air, I guess you could say. And also being immune compromised, their immune system's not gonna have a good chance. But you open up something that has aspergillus, one, you gotta wear a mask because we can get it. And you'll see that there's just mold patches all over their lungs and all over their air sacs. It's just really sad. It's really gross. Nasty, nasty stuff. A lot of seabirds are really prone to it. Also, kind of moist environments can promote aspergillus as well. Moist, warm environments. Oil spills are not a good place for aspergillus. Actually, a very good place for aspergillus. Not a good place for the animals. Because oil spills are very hot and very wet. Okay, so the difference between brand names and generic names. When I first started, we always had brand names. Like we had Baytril, and well, luckily cephalexin was called cephalexin. And we had, what are some of the other ones? Medicam, for example. And of course, right now I can't think of any of them. But you know all these brand names, and then the brand stops making it. And you're like, well, what was it to begin with? We've got to figure that out. So brand names can always be changed, but the generic name stays the same. So for example, like endrofloxin, it's much easier to say Baytril, but if Baytril ever stopped making endrofloxin, then it's endrofloxin. And sometimes if we find a brand that's cheaper when we're buying it, or if there is a generic brand of it, then we'll get that because it's less expensive. You know, same thing with you. If you go to Costco, you might buy the Kirkland over the whatever else they have. So it's always better to know the generic name, even though they're impossible to say, spell, and write. At least you can recognize them. You're like, okay, I recognize that 14-letter word. There's a P and an R and a Q. Okay, I think I know what this is for. So again, kind of, like I said to begin with, you may or may not be thrown into the med, doing meds. It's really important that it's done a certain way that, you know, depending on the type of animal, for raptors, for example, you have to have someone hold, and you have to have someone else pry the mouth open, and you got to get it all the way down, because you don't want it to get into their glottis, right? Because if you get into their glottis, then you aspirate them, so you don't want to get their drugs into their lungs. Not really a good place for their drugs. And then you have little tiny hummingbirds or a house finch or a grosbeak that won't even open its beak. So how do you give its meds when you can't physically open its beak, right? So there's, and a turtle. How are you going to give oral meds to a turtle, you know? You got to like tickle it in order to get its head to poke out. And you got to, you know, I mean, so generally, luckily, we do injectable for turtles and usually staph doesn't. But there's a lot of different species and there's a lot of different ways to give meds and doing it appropriately so that they don't fling it everywhere. And that you don't get it into their glottis so they don't aspirate on it. All those things are important. So again, if you are presented with giving meds, you will be trained on it, but you always want to double, triple check. And you can always double, triple check the people that you're working with too. Because believe it or not, when I've done on-shift trainings with the shifts that are up there on medications, it never fails if someone always pulls up the wrong medication or the wrong amount. I was just in one of the rooms, and I noticed that they pulled up like three syringes of itraconazole. It was like 2.7 cc's, but they used 1 cc syringes, and I'm like, 2.7? I was like, that's a huge amount of itraconazole, which is like $400 a bottle. And not only that, it's an antifungal. I mean, it's kind of harsh and nasty. So I was like, hold on, this is not right. Just intuitively, I'm like, nobody here has ever gotten 2.7 cc's of itraconazole. And we were doing a big red tail, and I'm like, you know, that this looks wrong. And so I went over to the board, and the one looked, it was, you know, a one that was like this, and I thought it was a two. So it would have got a whole cc more than it really needed, which could have been a problem, and nobody would have caught it. So double, triple, quadruple check yourself, and it's okay to check others. If something just looks wrong, and it's like, that's a whole lot of drugs, let me check the chart, let me check the board, still looks wrong, you can ask a supervisor, is this right? And sometimes there'll be an extra high dose for some reason or other. But generally, if it looks like it's way too much, and it's just in your experience, you're like, that's just a ton, then use your gut. Any questions about any of that?